Good evening and welcome to the NDTV Dialogues, a conversation of ideas. This week, all headlines have focused on Justice Markande Katchu's revelations on how a certain judge was appointed to the Madras High Court despite concerns that were raised by the collegium because of political intervention. The government has now announced that it will speed up decisions on appointments of judges. They're looking at a National Judicial Commission, they're looking at a new bill. But this all raises larger issues of the balance between the executive and the judiciary as well. Issues about judicial accountability, who will appoint the judges, who will judge the judges. Tonight, we focus our dialogue on these issues. Joining me tonight, Justice Markande Katchu, Soli Sorabji, Ashwini Kumar, Satyapal Jain and Indra Jaisingh. Thank you all very much for joining me tonight. Justice Katchu, you really put the cat amongst the pigeons this week. The furor that it has caused has the BJP, in fact, the law minister stood up in parliament and said that this raises certain issues. And outside parliament, we've heard various BJP ministers say that this shows that we need to look at what the UPA government's interference was and we need to look at a new system. Do you agree with critics who say that you strengthened the executive's case for saying that we should have a greater role in appointing judges? Do you feel the executive must now have a role in appointing judges? Because you've questioned how the collegium is working.
The executive must have a role, but the dominant role should be of judiciary.
Right.
And I have some ideas, which, if you permit me, I would like to put,
yes,
because representatives of Congress and BJP and eminent jurists like Mr. Soli Sorabji, Indra Ji are here. Firstly, the composition of the National Judicial Commission, which I would like to propose and it may be considered, 7-member Judicial Commission, of which first 4 should be the first 4 judges in seniority in the Supreme Court, Chief Justice of India and first 3 senior most judges. 5th member should be the Law Minister of India. 6th should be the representative of the largest opposition party in the Lok Sabha. And 7th should be a distinguished jurist appointed by the President of India. Now, this 7-member commission should first scrutinize the candidates, which they propose. Then they should call the candidate in a televised meeting where they can put questions to him, like the US Senate puts questions to the candidate, even about his personal life and also of his judicial working and so on. Whole of India should see the television proceedings where this 7-member commission puts questions to that candidate about himself. So that people should know, there should be transparency. In a democracy, people are supreme. People must know what is going on. I can tell you what my own personal experience. I retired as number 6 in seniority in the Supreme Court. First 5 judges, they treated me like untouchables. They would, I tell you, I felt so sad. They would never even whisper to me about what they were considering. Was I an untouchable? I was 6th in seniority when I retired. They just, you know, these people, they meet first 5 in a closed conclave. And even number 6 is an untouchable like me.
So you're saying it's
felt very hurt.
It's the opaque nature. Soli Sorabji, come in on that, because do you agree that the current collegium has now become a system which is fairly collapsed in a sense, it's not working anymore? But are you worried that it opens a Pandora's box? Because this is where you'll find politicians say we need to enter, and once you give an inch, it'll be a mile.
No. I think it's accepted now that the collegium system, the genesis was that we don't want Sarkari judges.
Mm-hmm.
How did it start? Kumar Ramangalam's committed judiciary theory and superseding judges of the Supreme Court who decided against the government in Keshavan Bharti. But somehow, original intent was good, but experience shows it hasn't worked satisfactorily. Correct. Now the question is, what do you do? What do you replace it with? After all, the whole idea is to have judges of able people of integrity and independent. Not independent merely from executive, independent from other centers of power. So the most important thing is the composition of the Judicial Commission. I am by and large in agreement with Justice Katchu about 7 people, and the other person may be appointed by the President, but only make one qualification, a President in consultation with the Chief Justice of India. Then 7 is okay. And after all, that all depends. Even those people who will appoint judges, they themselves must be not amenable to any pressure. Now, what do you do here in this scenario? You have executive as a voice, as it should have. There was another I might say the shortcoming of the collegium system, where judges had the exclusive voice, and the executive hardly had a look in, except they could send the reports. So it's a good thing, but I'm not in favor of televising it to the public, for the simple reason. Suppose I ask a judge, and for some reason they decide, well, he's clever, but he's not suitable. So he goes back to the High Court from where he is. If you televise it, what will happen to him? But litigants in that High Court say we don't want to appear before him. So idea of televising is, it's all very well that people are masters and all that, but some limit to it.
Before I get the politicians, and Indra Jaisinghe, the aspect that it was, the collegium was set up to avoid Sarkari judges. In that sense, the practice, or at least what Justice Katchu said, and what other cases which have come up in the past over the last few years, etc., about how judges are appointed. Mr. Jaitley, in his speech in the last Parliament session, had made the point of constituency judges, where there are other concerns which start coming in. Do you think that this is the way to go about it, that we do look at executive say now in appointment of judges? Do you worry sometimes that what the impact of this will be when, if you've seen, there have been cases where the executive, the caliber of the executive, the issue has come up. Do you think that's a worry? We have to look at how, it's all very well to say executive and judiciary, but it's also often boils down to the individual who's in that post.
It's a major cause for concern as far as I can see. You know, I agree that the executive should have a role in the matter of appointments. But it is my belief that they have a role even under the collegium system. The classic and recent example of that is the manner in which Mr. Gopal Subramanian was disqualified from being appointed for reasons that we don't need to go into. But the dominant role of the executive did emerge in, and let's not forget, that was under the collegium system. My own belief is that there is ordinarily a consensus between the judiciary and the executive. It is in very exceptional circumstances that there is a disagreement. Now, when we have a judicial commission, we are back to consensus appointments. Once again, you will have the four senior judges that they are proposing, as well as the executive, broadly agreeing with each other about who should be appointed. And I think this is something I would strongly disagree with.
Leader of the opposition.
Yes.
You're saying consensus has compromised in a sense.
Just a minute. I stand corrected. Mr. Sohrabji tells me that the leader of the opposition will also be part of this commission. Yes. But I find that there is a consensus between the judiciary, the leader of the ruling party, and the leader of the opposition by and large. So my question would be, where is the space for civil society to come in? Where is the opposite point of view? I'm not talking about exceptional situations where, of course, there could be disagreements. Mm-hmm. So I think that civil society needs to have a much larger role in the matter of appointment of judges. And it doesn't satisfy me that there is only one so-called eminent person who will be nominated by the president. And my own experience has been that, you know, there's no definition of who's an eminent person. You're back to the same situation where it could be like a former attorney general. I don't say they're not eminent. All I'm saying is that you're still keeping the appointment process in-house. You're not opening it up. And when you talk about concerns, we are today in a situation where we are ruled by a party which has a brute majority in Parliament. I think the dynamics of appointment change in a situation like that, and we have to be extra cautious to make sure that neither the judiciary nor the executive has the last word. There has to be a larger role for independent voices. And I don't see those independent voices being heard in the proposals which I've heard.
I'm going to go across to Ashwini Kumar, really, as a former law minister. And of course, the law minister would also be, is considered as probably part of the commission in the future. I mean, we'll see the final shape of the bill, of course. But Mr. Ashwini Kumar, the points raised, Indira Jaisingh raised the issue about Gopal Subramanian, but of course the immediate topic of this was the issue of what happened with this Madras High Court judge when another law minister, Mr. H.R. Bhadwaj, just defended it and said this is all right. And the point being made that in a sense there is already political interference in appointment of judges. How it's being done or in which way it's being done is not transparent at all, but it already exists. So are we actually opening it up to more? Is civil society, should it actually be an independent body almost like the UK has of judicial appointment? Why does the executive have to be the one who now shares the spoils in a sense with judges and appointing judges?
Merely because there's a representative of the executive in a parliamentary democracy, does an institution or a setup cease to be independent is the question that you must first answer. I think this whole debate is entirely skewed. It started from Justice Kaju's blog. First of all, it is utterly distasteful to bring in a man who has since ceased for the last several years and his conduct is being questioned. But that aside, and I am gravely disappointed that in this country that is happening.
Of course, the conduct is of the former Prime Minister and the former Chief Justice of India is being questioned.
We are going to be talking about that. You brought in the charge that the then Law Minister communicated with the then Chief Justice, and the then Chief Justice took a particular decision. Let me tell you, as Indira said, in no system of government can there be a situation where there is no communication between the government of the day, it may be any government, and another institution of parliamentary democracy, namely the judiciary at the level of the head of the judiciary. Just as consultation does not amount to concurrence, similarly consultation can never lead to an inference of pressure or interference. It is the most bizarre argument that I have heard for the last several days. I've been hearing this, and that's the reason I've come on your show. To just tell you this, as the Law Minister, several times references would come to me seeking clarification on a subject on which the then Prime Minister had received various representations. Now, if the Prime Minister of a day, it could be any government's Prime Minister, please do not forget that when the final recommendation goes to the President of India, after the report of the collegium is received, it is not under the signatures of the Chief Justice. It is under the signatures of the Prime Minister of India that the proposal is sent for making somebody the judge based upon the collegium's recommendation. Is the Prime Minister of the day not even allowed to seek a clarification when a representation is made to him on a particular issue? That is exactly what happened. Now, if you were to say that the reference was made to whom? To the Ministry of Justice. The Ministry of Justice, under the Transaction of Business Rules, is charged with the duty of communicating about the government's viewpoints or government's perspective to the judiciary. That does not mean that the then Chief Justice was obliged to ditto, even if a suggestion was made, assuming, I don't know what happened, even if it was made, he is not obliged to ditto it. And if he were to reiterate his recommendation, the government of the day under the present system would be bound. Therefore, this entire charge of political interference is so utterly absurd. And let me also tell you one thing, because I need to say this. In any civilized government, institutions need to work in harmony. There is no such thing as a government meaning the executive, being a pariah as far as judicial appointments are concerned. And let me also tell you that if there was one subject on which there was total unanimity in the last parliament and in the last government opposition interface, it was the Judicial Appointments Commission.
That's right.
There was never an issue.
That's what's worrying.
No, it was not worrying at all. I remember I myself sent my Secretary of Justice to Mr. Arun Jaitley then to have consultations with him. He was then the leader of the opposition Raj Sabha, so that we could come together to have a system that would not only work in practice, but would be seen to be fair by the people at large. I'm against a televised debate about appointment for the simple reason. Let's assume the entire committee on an interrogation, and I would say it will be nothing less than an interrogation of the prospective judge. It is otherwise diminishing to have that interrogation in public. Finds the person concerned suitable. What if the people of the country at large don't find him suitable? Will they withdraw the recommendation? Will we make the appointment of the judges in Chandni Chowk? You can't do that. There is an integrity to certain processes of decision making which can never be compromised. Each country has its own history. We don't have to ape the US system. I'm not saying for or against anything. Maybe at some point of time when we become more refined in our processes, maybe we can look at it. But merely because there will be a televised debate is not a guarantee of the suitability or non-suitability of a judge.
Mr. Chen, Indra Jaisingh made that point at Gopal Subramanian, but in a sense, the BJP has been happy with the revelations of Justice Kachun. In fact, the Congress has said that this is being done. The government is scoring points. It's not about truth. It's about the BJP government scoring political points on this. Mr. Ashwini Kumar raised the other point that on this judicial appointments bill, there's unanimity amongst the executive. The larger point I'm making is that when we look at the way ahead, how are we going to look to make this truly transparent, looking at the issues which are raised on the table, from televised debates to more involvement of civil society to keeping it confined? I mean, after all, executive is elected representatives. What do you think has to be done now without politics in it?
See, I'll reply to Mr. Ashwini Kumar's points a little later.
Yes.
First, let us be clear about the total procedure as set. Since independence, we have seen two systems of the appointment of the judges. Before S.P. Gupta's case, it was ultimately the dominance of the executive in the matter of appointment of judges. The law minister or the prime minister will consult, and the consultation was in certain cases reduced even to just intimation, not even effective consultation. This system had its own drawbacks, and ultimately S.P. Gupta's case 1992 or 1993, Supreme Court said no. In the matter of appointment and transfer of judges, the final say will be that of the judiciary. And a new system, which we now call as the collegium system, that came into existence somewhere in 92-93. So we have the experience of both. Nobody can say that one out of the two was the best. Both had their own plus points, both had their own negative points. And after the revelations of by Mr. Justice Kachun, the working under the collegium system has also been exposed. I don't agree with Mr. Ashwini Kumar that no, this issue should not have been discussed or that is not in good taste and all that. I think the weaknesses, the drawbacks, the failures of the collegium system could not have been exposed better than by Justice Kachun. A prime minister has no business to insist the collegium to recommend a person third time after twice the collegium has said, no, we don't want to give extension to him. As a matter of fact, the Prime Minister owes an explanation to the nation. The interaction between the judiciary and the executive doesn't mean that the government will insist on a particular name after having been rejected twice.
Look, we can politicize this debate.
See, he started it. I am replying only to that.
No, let him know. I was asked.
Nobody started.
Just a minute. You are factually not right.
Mr. Kumar, let him respond. Let him respond. And then we can move it on to another issue. But let him, he has to have a right to respond.
I think both these systems now, we have seen their working. We need to evolve a system where all these weaknesses can be reduced to the minimum. Everybody wants to have a good judge. Everybody wants to have a neutral judge. Everybody wants to have the judge with the best of the caliber and talent and all that. Now, how to find a system? Foolproof system we can't find. Ultimately, you may adopt any system. Therefore, now the time has come when almost all the major political parties are agreeing on the creation of a new institution called as the Judicial Commission for the appointment of the judges. The main issue of difference of opinion is about the composition of the Judicial Commission. Some people are of the view that, again, it is the judiciary which should have the predominance say in that matter. Some people feel no, not only the judiciary, but it should have the opinion of the experts also. I agree with Mr. Ashwini Kumar and I don't agree with Justice Kachun on one issue, that if you start interviewing judges and televising that on television and all that, it may not be in good taste. And there may be many people who may not like to subject to themselves to such type of interview before being appointed as judges. Therefore, the time has come, the point which I am concluding, that it's not an issue of any political party. It's not an issue of the BJP, Congress or any party. Let's evolve a national consensus on this issue, keeping in view the experience of both the systems, where we can have the best out of the available lot as the appointment of the judges.
I would agree with Mr. Ashwini Kumar's point that at the end of the day, you cannot have a system which excludes the executive. If you look at it, it's a more democratically elected executive than the judiciary can ever be. So even in terms of our theory of understanding of democracy, the executive has to have a role. But my friend here did not answer the question that the proposal that his party is making, who is going to be dominating? Is it going to be the executive? Is it going to be the judiciary? Or is there going to be a sort of multi member body which reflects the points of view of not just the executive and the judiciary, but many, many more voices. And let me say one last thing. Sonia, if you look at the composition of the judiciary today, I'm sorry to have to tell you that very often children of judges get appointed judges. One just has to make an analysis, okay? The same thing happens when it comes to designation of senior lawyers. The children of judges get designated senior lawyers, and then they become persons of eminence. And of course, you have to be a person of eminence to be appointed. I think this debate goes to the heart of the democracy that we call India. What exactly do we mean when we say that we want to have democratic processes? And in my opinion, the proposed judicial commission, and
yes,
and I don't want to be political about it, whether it was the UPA government's proposal or whether it is their proposal, I think both proposals were flawed to the extent that they exclude a lot of voices.
In fact, it was fascinating, Justice Kachu, that's why I want to bring in appointments, just one part of it. Actually, one other core issue which I think has got hidden in the all the noise which has been made around the revelation is the fact that charges of corruption. Now, of course, whether the IB report was valid, whether it was actually written, Mr. Bhadwaj said it was not. But the fact is that we keep hearing, and you've heard the various, and Prashant Bhushan and other lawyers have come together, raise this issue about corruption in the judiciary. Who looks at these issues? It also raised the issue what Indra Jaisingh just said about dynasty in the judiciary, in a sense, about whether it's who you know. The fact that this judge, that the reason that the party supported him is because of his caste, that they said that, you know, that he's being discriminated against because he's of a certain caste. In a sense, the ills of politics in a much lesser proportion are now with the judiciary as well.
See, that is why I have suggested that this judicial commission should not have only judges.
Mm.
This collegium system.
But this will just look at appointments. It doesn't go into these issues of corruption.
No, the same commission can examine. The same commission.
Accountability bill.
Same commission, seven-member judicial commission can also go into the question of charges of corruption and all. But the majority of this commission should be judges. Chief Justice of India and three senior most judges of the Supreme Court. Then fifth member should be Law Minister of India. Six should be from the opposition, the largest party in the opposition. And seven should be a distinguished jurist to be appointed by the President of India.
In consultation with the Chief Justice.
In consultation with the, listen, there have been Chief Justices and Chief Justices. Please don't talk of Chief Justice of India.
Not only
three Chief Justices of India, I have mentioned who compromised. What are you talking? Are they gods or Chief Justice of India?
But they are not demons either.
I am not saying that, but I am saying don't rely so much on Chief Justice of India. Many of them.
Who will you rely on?
That
only the president.
Listen to me. Since you ask a question, have the patience to listen. This I myself agree that how a distinguished jurist is to be chosen is to be discussed, debated. I don't have the answer, but don't trust the Chief Justice of India alone. I appointed three Chief Justices of India, who when there's an adverse IB report. This man, and I know it, I was in Madras, he was openly doing corruption.
Who is seeing alone?
India compromising?
I am not seeing alone.
According to your suggestion, it is
the president alone. I am not seeing alone.
Given the numbers, where is the balance?
Listen to me, but I never interrupted anybody when he was speaking.
Go ahead.
Except when you were in court.
I am saying that
then he's a judge allowed to.
There should be executive. The law minister should be in this commission. One representative of opposition should be there and one jurist. But the majority should be of judges because they are in a better position too. It should not be exclusively judges as it is in the collegium system. That is all that I have said.
But I think my clarification was only, if I may permit.
Yes.
See, on the one hand, you are saying that the President of India should not depend on the advice of the Chief Justice alone for the purpose of appointment of a jurist on the commission. On the other hand, you are yourself suggesting that four out of the six members of the judicial commission,
seven members, should
be the judges. Is it not contradictory?
No, there is no contradiction. Because, you see, when you have a larger body, not Chief Justice of India alone, they will cross-check. You see, I was in the collegium of Allahabad High Court. I was number three in Allahabad High Court. One member was proposing names of people who were totally undeserving. I strongly objected. I said I will not allow these appointments to go through.
Then why not to have a balanced commission?
I think let's get back.
Balanced commission.
Let me go to Ashwini Kumar, because actually raise another issue. When the UPA had originally come up with this bill, whereas there may have been unanimity amongst political parties, The backlash or the outcry was that the reason the UPA is doing this was because of the judiciary had become so strong that at that time there were a series of judgments which were seen as anti-UPA. You faced the brunt of that as well, and then you resigned. But I'm saying the reason it was being seen as that the executive wants to take back the reins of power because they feel that the judiciary is, the judicial activism has gone out of control.
But not just
do you agree that there was any sense of that at all? And do you feel that there is a need of restoring balance?
Look, there are two entirely different questions. Right. About the need for restoring balance is self-evident in the proposal that is before the parliament, which we have discussed in the first round. On the second, the point that you made is, in a sense, a suggestion that the UPA made this proposal because it wanted somehow a control over the appointments process. Even in that proposal, the control does not vest with the executive. It vests with the body in which the judges outnumber the others, number one. Number two, if that was our intention, could we have forged unanimity with the opposition who was baying for our blood? Number three. The other question you talked about, me bearing the brunt, that is not germane to this debate, and that was a charade, it was a joke, but anyway, it happened. The point I'm trying to make is, we have reached a stage in the evolution of a democracy when no one institution can stand alone to govern this country, when no one individual is so powerful as to have his writ run transcending other imperatives. And I'm very happy for my country because we have arrived at this stage. But there's one point I want to make about what Justice Kaju, for whom I have the greatest respect, said. He said, don't trust the Chief Justice. And he said, I have pointed to three Chief Justices of India who could not have been trusted. He can trust an IB inspector, but he will not trust three Chief Justices of India of an institution of which he has been a distinguished member. And he would not trust a former Prime Minister. He would not trust
You are twisting my words. I said don't trust him alone.
The burden of your entire argument,
Justice Kaju, is the three Chief Justices of India did something wrong. If three Chief Justices of India, in their wisdom, and who were not amenable to any pressure under the collegium system by anyone, chose to decide one way, surely there must be some presumption in favor of what they did. I am not joining issues, I am not privy to what the IB report said, but I have been the law minister and I have seen IB reports.
Yeah.
It is so dangerous to put total faith in the report of one institution. I am not saying disregard it, that is one input. But to say that must prevail over everything else, I'll give you an example. There's one person everybody knows, but I'm not going to name that. A good friend of ours.
Boozer?
His pet name is Boozer. But the man is a teetotaler. Once his appointment was held back because IB said he's a drinker.
Yeah.
So this is also one of the instances. So for heaven's sake, in a country where we have learned to live by the rule of law, the essential and the non-negotiable postulate of that is presumption of innocence of a person until established to be guilty. We have reversed that. We have given undue weightages to some reports here and there, and we have of course got the great trial by media, which Mirajkar case, five judges of the Supreme Court said should never happen, and it is happening under the wise gaze of the Supreme Court. Nobody has called that into question. Reputations are wrecked. People have had to pay a price because once the damage is done, then there's a new news the other day and that person can go to hell. So let me tell you this, no institution of parliament's democracy can survive on its own. And let us bring balance not only between three institutions of governance, but between how we have conducted our democracy so far.
I just want Justice Kaju to quickly respond to that specific point. Go ahead. Do you want to respond,
see,
Justice Kaju?
He does not know the facts. Mr. Ashwini Kumar does not. I was the Chief Justice in the Madras High Court. He was not there.
We're not talking about the Madras.
Because he spoke about.
No, I think the specific point.
May I be permitted to open my mouth in the presence of you people? I am not saying rely on that adverse IB report alone. First, I made my investigations. I was Chief Justice of Madras High Court. It was not reliance on IB report again, alone. IB report was only when I went to Justice Lahoti. I said, I've got a lot of information that this man is indulging in corruption.
All right, so
but you please don't rely on me alone. You will get an IB report also. So that confirmed what I was saying.
So I think
Mr. Ashwini Kumar, know the facts correctly.
So I think
no, I know the facts.
No, you don't. I know.
No, Judge, no, let's not argue.
Okay,
I didn't want to argue.
Let's take that point.
I am saying, then let Justice Lahoti or Justice Sabharwal come and say why they didn't agree with what your recommendations were. I mean, the point is, I may not know the facts, at least they know the facts. There must be some presumption in their favor.
But I think the point is
let's not forget the man in question that he's talking about is dead and not even in
prison.
The point is that one other member of that same collegium, Justice Pal, did say today that she also wrote a letter questioning the decision. The point is the fact that it's completely opaque. No one knows what happened, which is why we can debate without facts.
That's why the Judicial Commission.
Let's come to this. Let's see the area of convergence.
Yes.
We are all agreed.
Exactly.
Yes.
Collegial system must go. There must be a composition. I agree with Justice Kachu that judiciary should not be exclusive, but it must tilt in favor. Judges know the work of the judges in the High Court. They know the laws who appear before them. They're in a better position to judge. But not exclusive.
We talk about the composition of this commission. It's of course an interesting fact that we don't have a leader for opposition and we may not have a leader for opposition in this parliament. Yeah, when we look at who we're going to actually include in this bit what IB reports, the charge against this government was that IB reports leaked selectively in the Gopal Subramanian case, issues about him being spiritual that the IB found suspicious. So in that sense, just as the UPA, the ex-UPA government may have this sword to bear, the NDA government also has this sword to bear where people may be mistrustful of your motives now.
See, after the entire discussion, as Soli Surabji pointed out, there is no disagreement on 2-3 submissions. Number one, both these systems had their flaws. Both these systems have, if I may say so, failed.
Yes.
We are now in search of a third system where there is a balance between the two. The balance between the executive, balance between the judiciary, and as she is suggesting, civil between society. Certain organized civil society and other organizations also. I remember somebody said last evening on the television, that instead of having the interviews, etc., of the persons who are going to be appointed judges by the Judicial Commission, let their names be televised. So that if you have any view, this may be conveyed to the decision making. Sir, neither we can have full faith and say final say to the IB, nor we can give that final say to the Chief Justice, nor even to the Law Minister or the Prime Minister. And with all respect, not even to the President of India. Ultimately, the issue revolves around one thing. What will be the composition of the commission, which will ultimately recommend? And now there is no difference of opinion that it should be a balanced commission. It should have people representative both from the judiciary also, as well as from the public men of eminence. I see
what if there isn't a leader of opposition?
Yes,
what?
No harm. Leader of the opposition also should be consulted.
No, but what if there isn't?
And if there is no leader of the opposition, then you can consult the leader of the largest party. See, our government is with open mind on this issue. It's not an issue of BJP, Congress and all that. It's not the issue of any political party. I feel that like a foreign policy, let there be broad consensus on the appointment of the judges transferred to the judiciary also. So therefore, you have started a debate in the right perspective. Let people involved in it. Our government has called the meeting of all the political parties. We are open to all suggestions being given. Ultimate aim is not to have the final say either to the executive or to the judiciary. Second thing, a small reply to Mr. Ashwini Kumar's question that he said that all the three chief justices should come and explain. I think not only the three chief justices about the allegation of Mr. Karju. The Prime Minister should also come. Why is the former Prime Minister, who was at that time at the helm of the affairs, why he is also keeping silent?
Because let he all speaks the players, to the Law Minister.
I say, let me make the point. Let all the players, whether the former Chief Justice,
I've never said that.
Whether the former Law Minister or former three Chief Justices, all of them owe an explanation to the nation about the allegation leveled by Justice
Karju. H.R. Bhardwaj has come out to make separatists come out, but let Indra Jaisingh go ahead.
Yeah, I have 2 points to make.
Yes.
One is to respond to Mr. Sorabji's point about whether civil society is competent to opine on these issues. Now, here's what I say. There must be predetermined criteria for the appointment of a judge. So by what are we going to judge? No, and let me make a suggestion if it meets with your approval.
Sure.
Obviously, this commission must have a very, very strong secretariat with very, very renowned academics in the secretariat. Now, the job of the secretariat, see, if you're talking about
full-time commission.
Yes. If you're talking about appointment from High Court to Supreme Court, I think the job of the secretariat would then be to sit and analyze all the judgments that the nominated judge has passed during his tenure as a judge of the High Court, and that report should be made public so that we all get an opportunity to comment on it. Now, while analyzing judgments, what are we going to look for? We're going to look for knowledge of law. We're going to look at the quality of writing. We're going to look for clarity of thought. We are going to look for a certain commitment to human rights.
Correct.
And we are going to look for commitments to, say, for example, women's issues, which concerns me a hell of a lot.
Social
I know
justice.
Judges in the of high courts who have made the most derogatory comments about women while they were high court judges, and they found their way. I know judges of the Supreme Court who have made very derogatory comments against women. They're still there. So we really need to have a checklist, a certain criteria, a research document. And the document must also contain information about the person's personal biodata, assets, disclosure of income, source of income, so that if you want to know about credibility in terms of corruption, you must know their assets, you must know their income, you must know their sources of income, and let the people judge whether, you know, there is a valid reason. And then, I say, allow civil society to voice its concerns. You may not want them on the commission. That's a different issue.
But I agree.
But an open forum where complaints
can come up. This opportunity must be given.